Expense 109. Ready? Abhivadan Silissa.
Abhivadan Silissa.
Nityam Vaddha Pachayino.
Nityam Vaddha Pachayino.
Chattaro Dhamma Vaddanti.
Chattaro Dhamma Vaddanti.
Ayu Anno Sukhang Balam.
Ayu Anno Sukhang Balam.
Abhivadana Silissa. Nityam Vaddha Pachayino. Chattaro Dhamma Vaddanti. Ayu Anno Sukhang Balam. I think you have heard these recitals more than thousands times. The monks always recite this for thanksgiving as well as blessing, or when people pay respect, they recite these verses. The meaning, for one who is in the habit of constantly honoring and respecting the elders, four blessings increase: age, beauty, bliss, and a strength. That is the meaning of the sayings of the Buddha. The Buddha had to recite this due to certain incident. A young man who has renounced the worldly life and started to lead an ascetic life, just like isolated person who keep away from the society, try to develop their mind to maintain more peace and satisfaction, because in the society there are a lot of disturbances. It's very difficult to maintain peace. Very irritable feeling, disturbances, as well as temptation, disturb the mind. So to avoid all these things which disturb the mind, people keep away from the society and lead a peaceful life in an isolated place. After leading that ascetic life for a few years, he had a second thought. That is, if I lead this religious way of life, there is nobody to maintain our family traditions or lineage. Therefore, I must go back and get married and produce children. It is our bounden duty. Now, this habit or this traditional belief is common amongst certain Indians and mostly Chinese. In India, they have a different belief. Every man, married man, must have a son, not the daughters. Because, according to their traditional belief, only son can transfer the merits after their departure. after their death. Because son carries the name, the family name, and not the daughter. Anyway, Buddhism does not agree with this. This is only ancient Indian belief. So if the first wife could not produce a son, so the man is allowed to have a second wife because of, or for the sake of a son. But in China, they have different belief. They have three responsibilities or duties. They regard them as debts. First thing is, they are indebted to God. The way how they fulfill their duties towards God, by performing various kinds of rites, rituals, sacrifices, prayers and offerings. Because the concept of God among Chinese in those days entirely different from the concept of Christians or Muslims. They never had a belief of a creator God. Chinese philosophy says it is far better to develop relationship with the man, not with the God. So when we develop our relationship with the man, man means mankind or human beings, we can lead a very healthy and peaceful life. This is their belief at that time. So even then, they believe that there are some devas or deities or God that they had to please by doing some offerings. That is why they have various kinds of offerings to different gods. Such gods were very popular in those days in India, China and Greece. They had thousands or hundreds of thousands or millions of gods and goddesses. In India, there were 33 million gods and goddesses. So they had to worship and pray to all of them. Because for everything that which happened here in this world, they refer to God. Rain is God. Sun is God. Moon is God. Wind is God. Thunder, lightning, God. For everything. So they started to worship and pray. Therefore, this duty is very common among Chinese to fulfill certain duties to satisfy or to please the God. That is why they are particular about rites and rituals and burning so many things in the name of God or their departed. Second duty is their duty toward the ancestors, ancestral worship, started in China, now popular in Korea and Japan and other countries also. The main idea is, when they respect their ancestors who have contributed or who have done something for them or for their families or for their countries, they think it is their duty to remember them, to respect them, do something for them. for that, the most important thing is not to break the link, the lineage. That means every man must get married and produce children. That is the way how they maintain their lineage. That is the way how they satisfy their ancestors. We have noticed this very carefully. Even today, Chinese are not ready to sacrifice their sons to become monks because of this. Only unwanted sons can join the army and become monks. Because those who join the army and no guarantee whether they come back or not. And the monks' way of life is worse than that. Soldiers may come back, but the monks don't come back. So they regard these two, soldiers and monks, are as useless toward their family because they break their link or the lineage. I remember a few years ago, a young man wanted to become a monk. Then we told him we cannot do that without the permission from the father and mother. So he went to discuss with his father. Then he came with him. When he said that he wants to become a monk, the father said, "I don't like it." The son was very particular. Then he said, "If you are not going to allow me to become a monk, I'm going to become a drug addict or to join with gangsters." Father said, "I don't mind." "No objection, but you cannot become a monk." Can you understand how strong this belief amongst Chinese? Because he is going to break this family tradition or link. So, still we could not convince our Chinese devotees. Every time when we organize our novitiate program, at least two or three young people say, "We'd like to stay back and continue this way of life." Then we say, "All right, go and discuss with your parents and let us know." And some have never returned. And some mothers say, "Sorry," father say, "Cannot," mother say, "Cannot." This is the problem. And because of this belief, they maintain this don't know how many thousands of years. Third one is, their duties and responsibilities toward sages, gurus. They say, "We must learn what they have taught." This is the only way that we can respect our gurus, our teachers, who have taught us some good ideas, morals and ethics and noble way of life. So these three, duties and responsibilities, duties toward the devas or God, duties towards their ancestors and duties toward their sages or gurus, they maintain. So this young man, after thinking very deeply, he decided to go back, return to his worldly life, got married, produced a child. Later, he came to see the Buddha with this child. Because astrologers and some others predicted that this boy can live only for a very short period. So he was very worried about that. Then went to the Buddha and told him, many people said that this boy cannot live long, maybe a few months or a few years. Then the Buddha wanted to see actually what is happening. Because there are various obstructions and hindrances for our life. Not only our own karma, there are many external obstructions for our existence. There are so many evil spirit, ghost who can influence our life. I think these few days you have read many articles which appeared in the State Times about the spirit and ghost. Now it seems Hindus, Buddhists, Christians, Muslims and scientists also accept, yes, there are some spirit and ghost. Although they agree, but we have to use our common sense also. Then the planetary system, different planets influence our life, can shorten our life or strengthen our life. Plant life, living beings are subjected. We can understand only sun and the moon, how far they can influence our life. If there is no sun, there is no life here. Life exists because of the sun, under the solar system. And the moon is influencing the fluid, especially in our brain, blood, already accepted, no argument. Full moon days we can see some people laugh and talk and dance. Very unusual. Changes take place in their mind through the influence of the moon. The brain cells were disturbed by the fluid in the brain. Just like high tide, low tide, the moon is responsible for that. Plant life, blooming flowers and bearing fruits, or either support or obstruct by the moon. People know according to their experience, thousands of years. That is why farmers say, this period we should not plant either paddy or fruit trees because the moon is influencing according to their experience. So planetary system can change our life. Again, external influence, sun, wind, water or heat can influence our life to shorten or to increase. Again, internal disturbances, elements, energies in our physical body can create enormous problems and disturbances to shorten our life. Mind itself can create many problems physically and mentally. when you read Girimananda Sutra in Parit chanting book, the Buddha has mentioned the names of various sicknesses and problems that we are facing. And some of them, the Buddha has mentioned as Kamma Vipakaja Abadha. We are facing so many problems and sicknesses due to certain bad karmas that we have committed during our previous birth. But not all our sicknesses or troubles or problems, only certain things. Then the Buddha says, Uttuparinamaja abadha, opakkamika abadha, visuma pariharaja abadha. Internal, external provocation, disturbances can create so many sicknesses. They have nothing to do with karma. Again, our behavior, our character, our mental attitude can create so many sicknesses and problems. So when this man reported to the Buddha knew that it is not due to one of his bad karma, but due to certain external influence that can be overcome or stopped. So what he did, this is the first time the Buddha has advised the group of monks to go to his house and start the paritta chanting in his house the whole night. Through the influence of this paritta chanting, the external forces that influence this child to shorten his life disappear. This is a very important point here. When we listen to certain chanting or paritta or sutra, definitely we can experience some good result, but many others won't get anything. But in the Buddha's teaching, it is mentioned that there are three hindrances that obstruct for us to gain any good result after reading or listening to any paritta chanting or blessing. What are those three? Kammavarana, Kilesavarana, Jnayavarana. Are these three hindrances? Kammavarana, karmic obstruction. If we have committed very heavy, very strong, bad karmas, either within this lifetime or during our previous birth, paritta chanting or blessings cannot do anything, cannot stop us. The Buddha also cannot do anything for them. This is the nature of the karma, because the Buddha also had to face so many karmic effects. So it's called Kamma Vipaka. Kamma Avarana. Avarana means object. The second one is Kilesa Avarana. Kilesa means mental hindrances, mental defilements or mental impurities. When the chanting is going on, if we do not develop our faith, confidence, devotion, then what will happen? Certain evil thoughts prevail and dominate, occupy the mind. Then we don't experience any good result. Either selfishness or anger or jealousy or grudge or ill will or enmity, if one of those evil forces are working in the mind while we are listening to this chanting or while we are reciting, we cannot experience a good result. Because the mind is not ready to receive, no receptive power. Therefore, we have to develop devotion, confidence, then create some sort of inspiration. That inspiration spread all over the body, physical body, and affect the organs, the heart, the lungs or the kidneys or the liver, nervous system, brain cells. That is how people get the chance to get rid of their sicknesses. The more they develop their devotions and confidence, the more easily they can get rid of their sicknesses and problems. That is called Kilesa Ava. Third one is Nyaya Avara. Nyaya means understanding. Avarana means obstruct. People don't believe. They cannot understand. They do not know how to appreciate. Just only for the name's sake or for curiosity's sake, they come and attempt to this kind of chanting or blessing. They also cannot experience any good result because their skeptical belief reject the efficacy or the good result of this chant. These are the three hindrances. Remember this. First thing, that we can understand. If we have done a very bad, very heavy karma, and no one can change that karmic effect, I think you have heard Dr. Edgar Casey in America. I got a book also, written by another doctor who associated with him, worked with him. He died in 1945. There are 30,000 cases that he has recorded in his book. We attended to them. The sickness that he had was condemned by the doctors as incurable. But he did not give up hope. What he did, he developed his psychic power, just like getting into trance, without depending on any god or any religion, mere psychological. He developed and developed and developed and developed. After that, he could manage to penetrate into his own subconscious mind and get lot of information. You know, our subconscious mind is a gold mine actually, as well as dustbin. all the good and bad activities, knowledge, memories, good habits, bad habits that we have stored, deposited in the subconscious mind. And when people are hypnotized, they remember some of them, their previous birth also, their names and all the particulars. Because the normal mind is dealing with the five senses and imagination. That's all, very limited. When that mind gets a chance to penetrate into subconscious mind, then we can recall and remember many languages, many things that we have developed during our previous birth. This we can understand very easily when you study the life of the Buddha. How he started, how he went on developing and developing and developing life after life, by reducing all the bad things, cultivating, developing all the good things, and mental purification in between. So he continued life after life because of that mental habit, that mental formation. All of us have this. But in our case, we have no such determination or aspiration that we want to gain, we want to develop this further and further. We spend this for our day-to-day life. But we can continue. So, the mind can develop and recall after attaining arahantahood or becoming a Buddha, when all the impurities, defilements removed, eradicated from the mind, and the mind becomes very, very pure. Then the brightness is there. And then they can see. They can recall all their previous activities, what they have done. So this Edgar Casey, he got cured his own sickness, because he discovered the medicine by using his own money, not from outside. Then people started to visit. Today, that institute is still open in Virginia, America. 30,000 cases were recorded in his record book. What happened? When he get into trance, he said, "I am sorry, it is impossible to cure your sickness," to some people, he says. Why? This is the bad effect of the bad deed, the cruel deeds that you have committed during your previous birth. He was not a Buddhist. He has never studied karma or rebirth, but when he gets into trance, develop his psychic power, he says like this. Certain other cases, he says yes, can be cured. Then he prescribes certain medicine, mostly herbal medicine, herbs or flowers or roots or bark or certain, not modern drugs. many people had the opportunity to get rid of their sicknesses. This is a living example for all of us. But when his mind is normal, he has no idea about rebirth or karma or anything, because the normal mind cannot understand. Now we cannot understand what we have done, what sort of good and bad deeds we have done during our previous birth. We cannot understand. But if we can develop our mind, then we can remember. Why do we suffer like this? Because it is due to certain bad things that we have done. Why do we enjoy our life while others are suffering? It is due to certain good deeds that we have done. So in simple language, the Buddha used only two sentences for this. I have repeated this more than 1,000 times. Can you remember what it is? Now that is the trouble with you. You cannot remember even that much. We are the result of what we were. We will be the result of what we are. So simple. That means, if we are suffering while others are enjoying in this world, it is the result of what we were, what we have done during our previous birth. If we enjoy our life while others are suffering, it is the result of what we were. We have done some good deeds during our previous birth. Then, he says, we will be the result of what we are. What we are doing here today becomes the cause for us to either enjoy our life or to suffer. So be wise. Don't make use of this body or this life to suffer in the next life. So if you act wisely, you can avoid the suffering. You can lead a peaceful, very happy, contented life. But you must know how to handle this life very reasonable way, respectable way. And then nothing to worry about the next life. We are so greedy, so selfish, so jealous, so wicked and cunning. And these are our enemies. These enemies encourage us to do all sorts of bad things, immoral things, wicked things, for immediate benefit, result. We commit one of these things. But later, we had to pay the price, either within this lifetime or hereafter, after our death. This is the nature of our life. These are the things that we have to learn from the religion. How to handle this life. How to lead a harmless life as much as possible. Otherwise, we have to pay. When you look at the whole world, we can see so many living examples. Why so many discrimination, differences, calamities, violence, bloodshed, and destruction? On the other hand, how people are enjoying their life. Here one side, burning, destroying, cutting, slaughtering. But the other side, enjoying, dancing, merrymaking, drinking. Why it is like that? Who is responsible for that? We are responsible. Nobody else. By knowing this situation, we must understand. Religion is important for that. not only to worship or pray or do some rites and rituals, but to learn this, to adjust our way of life, to use this life reasonable way, respectable way, by maintaining our human dignity and human values. And then we gain confidence. Now we have no confidence. We are scared. We have worries. We have fear, suspicion. Why? Minds are very weak. No more mental energy wasted for unnecessary things. But when you learn these things, when you gain confidence, then you can recharge the battery in your mind to rejuvenate, strengthen your mind. Then you can stand firmly without fear, without worry, without crying. That is what the Buddha wanted. He did not introduce this religion for people to come and worship him. To him, makes no difference at all whether you worship him or not. If you lead a respectable life, a noble life, after listening to his teaching, then he will be happy. That is what he wants. You can say you are Buddhist because you worship the Buddha. That is not the Buddha wanted. I think you can remember, when he was about to pass away, devas, ministers, princes, assembled there to pay their last respect to the Buddha with flowers. Ananda, his attendant, told them, "The Buddha is in very critical condition. Please don't go and disturb him." The Buddha overheard what Ananda thought. Then the Buddha said, "Ananda, you must go and tell them. If they really want to pay respect to their master or their teacher, they can do that by following the advices given by the teacher, not by offering flowers and worshipping. Ask them to go and practice what I ask them to." Now you can see who the Buddha is, what he wanted. After that, the Buddha has given instruction and guidance to the monks to visit this man's house and perform this all-night chanting blessing for the sake of this child. Next day, the Buddha also visited this house. Then he has seen all the obstructions and hindrances all disappear, all gone. Then he has given him a new name to this boy, Ayuvardhan. Ayu means years, Y-E-A-R, years. Vardhan means dear. Ayuvardhan, in simple language, long life. The boy who was supposed to pass away, to die within few months, lived 120 years because of this blessing. The external hindrances, obstructions disappeared. And this is a very important saying of the Buddha. Then he recites this. We can avoid so many disturbances, especially through the evil forces, influences, planetary system. Astrology is true. We cannot say it is wrong. But the Buddha's advice is don't surrender yourself even to the astrologer. You can suffer the planet just like missiles. One country sends missile to another country. In that country also they produce missiles and missiles cannot go through that country and turn there. Last time when Iraq sent some missile to Israel. American provided very strong missile to face him and turn and drop halfway. Exactly in the same manner. When you develop our mental energy, you can topple the energy that comes through the planet and cosmic energy. Mental energy is more powerful than the cosmic energy. At the beginning, Christians are strongly opposed this astrology. Later, a well-known Christian saint, Saint Thomas Aquinas, a well-known personality in Christians, he said, planets can influence our physical body, but not the mind. He is right. The Buddha has said this earlier. The planet can influence the elements of our body, but not the mind. So the Buddha's advice is, when you develop this mental energy, those planets cannot influence even the elements of the body. Now this is the nature of the mind. We do not know how to make use of our mind. Very unfortunately, we surrender our mind to others. We listen to others always what they talk. We believe them. That means we have not developed our mental energy and understanding. So if we can develop this, we know what to do and what not to do. Not necessary to listen to others. You know, well-known, very highly intellectual person who died recently, Krishnamurti. He has independent ideas, not belong to any religion. Most of his time is spent in the West. He believed that those who take ideas from others are second-class human beings. You understand? Second-class, because they haven't got their own. Always believe what others say. They have not trained their mind to think. The main purpose of the Buddha's teaching is to train people how to think and understand. Not to accept religion as a law given by somebody. Not to accept religion as commandment commanded by someone. But by giving some ideas for them to think and understand, then we know whether it is right or wrong. So we should not become second-class human beings. As Buddhists, we can say we are first-class human beings. We don't depend on, Buddha said, don't depend on me. Thinking Buddha is a great man. You never realize anything. You think Buddha is a great man, therefore you must accept him. But you never realize why. The example that I always give you to understand the nature of Buddha's teaching, I repeat this again and again. Attanam upamam katva nahaneya nagataye. If you cannot understand killing, destroying other's life is wrong, then you have to think in this way. When another person come and try to kill you, how do you feel? The fear, tension, worries, sufferings, how many things are there for you to suffer when another person come and try to kill you? When you try to kill another living being, that living being also experience the same thing that you experience. This is more than enough for you to understand why killing is bad. Not necessary to get any divine message from heaven to understand that killing is wrong. People say, oh, we don't kill because God asks us not to kill. Otherwise we can kill. Oh, we don't kill because we are Buddhist. Buddha said not to kill. And they are all second class human beings. Before all these religions come into existence, people knew, they realized killing is bad, stealing is bad, telling lies is bad. They knew all these things. So these things have not come down from heaven, not from the mouth of God. If we say, the Buddha says we should not kill, therefore we don't want to kill. You are stupid. Why it is necessary to depend on Buddha? You also can understand that killing is bad. That is what the Buddha says. Don't depend on Buddha. Say, Buddha says like this, therefore we do like this. You also must try to understand. See the way how he, the technique he adapted made you to understand things properly by thinking. You have that thinking power. But you never give chance for that thinking power to develop and develop and develop and understand things properly. Religions have their religious law, commandment for you to believe. Then you believe but you never think. Stop your thinking. The Buddhism is not that type of religion. It is for you to think and think and think and understand. Then you give due credit to your intelligence, not to abuse it. And this saying, for one who is in the habit of constantly honoring and respecting elders. What is the meaning of elders here? Elders does not mean old people. The Pali word, there are two words here, vadda, another word buddha. Abhivadana silisa nichyam buddhapachayana, oh vaddhapachayana, same meaning. Elders means those who have developed their maturity, their knowledge, their wisdom, their understanding, their virtues, their good qualities, they are the elders. And why do people respect them? In appreciation of their development, of the good qualities and virtues, people bow down kneel down, respect, in honoring them. So when you respect them with this understanding, in return, you gain four things. Ayu, Vanna, Sukha, Bala. Four things. Immediate result. Not hereafter. Long life. Here, this young boy, supposed to die in a short period, but he lived 120 years. Ayu. When we say, you know, in different languages, they have different ways of greeting people. Western ways, how do you do? Not very meaningful to us. But the way how we greet others in Sri Lanka, in Sinhalese language, is very meaningful. There's no such thing as good morning, good afternoon, good day or good night. Only one word at any time. What is that? Ayu Bhavan. Anytime. Ayu Bhavan. Long life. Everybody likes it. This is the way of greeting. When you meet anybody, first thing you say, Ayu Bhavan. And the other person also says, Ayu Bhavan. Long life. Very meaningful way of greeting. Long life. And that will become some sort of blessing. Because that person says Ayu Bhavan without any ulterior motive. As his contribution, goodwill, understanding, compassion, friendship, Ayu Bhavan. I think there's no harm for you to learn this Sinhalese word. If you meet this time, you say Ayu Bhavan. Like Vesak, the word is a Sinhalese word. But you use the word Vesak here and all over the world. A Sinhalese word. Vesak. Ayu Bhavan. In India also, in another forms, another way they greet. In Hindi language, they say, Aapka tabiyat achcha hai. How is your health? Alright? It's a greeting. To me, that how do you do is not very meaningful. Sometimes I ask, when they ask, how do you do? I ask, why do you want to know how I do? To me, it is not very meaningful. Although maybe I'm a stupid who can understand the real meaning. But these words are very meaningful. And here in this country, Sudama Khan is a greeting. Concern for others. Way of greeting. So here the Buddha says, those who pay respect to the elders, who are worthy of respect, irrespective of their religion or race or color, immaterial. That is why Chinese, they come and kneel down, pay respect to Indian monks, Sri Lankan monks, and the monks from other countries. They know they are belong to different race, different color, but they have courage and knowledge and understanding to come and kneel down and pay respect. Appreciations of these good qualities, not the person, not the color, not the race. This person is virtuous, he is noble, he is harmless, he has more maturity, more knowledge, more understanding. So we bow down and respect. In return, you get Ayu Vanna Sukha Bala. Because he also recites this, come from his heart. Vanna means complexion. Now if you do this, especially ladies, regularly, you can reduce, you can, your cosmetic, you can reduce the loss. naturally you get the complexion. No need to apply so many things. Complexion, because the happiness that they gain, inspirations that they gain, the mind influence the physical body, blood circulation, the blood goes through the tiniest blood vessels, then the complexion becomes shiny. When person attains sainthood, can see the serenity, very pleasant looking, because no dirty ideas, no wicked ideas in their mind. Small baby. Why everybody loves a baby? Even the wicked, cruel man also loves a baby. Because this baby is innocent. Still not develop anger, jealousy, grudge and ill will and wicked things. Therefore, everybody loves this child. So the Arahantas and Buddhas and saints are just like that small baby. So innocent, harmless. Therefore they bow down and respect. And if they get the blessing in return. Then Sukha. This word Sukha you know very well. Happy, peaceful, prosperous, contented life. That means you get the chance to lead a comfortable, peaceful life. That is called Sukha. Bala, a strength. Mental energy and physical energy. When the mind is developed, we gain the physical energy. The mind is weaker, the physical body is also. But when the mind, when body is weakened, still we have the chance to maintain the energy in the mind, mental energy. This is another advice given by the Buddha. When you are sick physically, don't allow your mind to be sick. You can maintain healthy mind although you are sick physically. That healthy mind gives you confidence. Then slowly that sickness also reduce and reduce and reduce. That confidence is very important when we are sick. So when you are sick, don't worry too much. Don't create frustration, disappointment, don't cry. Have confidence. That energy supports you to get rid of your sickness. Now this is the nature of mental energy. So, Ayuvanna Sukha Bala. These four things we gain in return when we pay homage, when you pay respect to those who are worthy of respect. That is the Buddhist attitude. You can respect anybody, whether that person is a Christian or Hindu or Muslim, makes no difference. If you think that person is virtuous, you can pay respect no harm. I remember many years ago, Archbishop Vandenen visited this temple. So he wanted to shake hands like this. Then I told him, this is not our oriental custom. So he is an Indian. I told him, this is not an oriental custom. We must do like this, greeting to each other. So we started. Now, every time when we meet, we greet like this. And one of our Sinhalese Buddhists, very orthodox, you know, still there are very orthodox Buddhists, you know, and having seen this, he scolded me. Why did you worship that man? Then I told him, you must understand the difference between worshipping and greeting. There are two things. especially in India, everybody, they greet like this. They don't like to shake hands in this way. This is greeting, not worshipping. Worshipping means we go down and do like this. That is called worshipping. Pay homage. But they cannot understand this. So we have to develop. This is a very noble, very meaningful tradition. We have to learn. To anybody, even a child, last time when Dalai Lama, supposed to be the king of the country, people say living Buddha, or incarnations of so and so. Even to a small child, he was respected. So humble. He wanted to become so humble, reduce his pride. So when we respect, pay homage to a person, we reduce our pride, our stubbornness, and egoism. We calm and reduce them, become very humble. That is very important to train our mind. So these customs, traditions, those they have introduced for this purpose. Yes. Coming to 9:30. So you have learned something today, I hope. You try to practice as much as possible that you can. And the announcement about this, the free ticket to attend this, who got the ticket?
Came back. I quit Sabah's job. I came back. Then one time a Sri Lankan monk came and stayed in Sungai Besi, one of the shop lots there. So I volunteer to drive him around if he need to go anywhere. So one day, on that day, he went to Sentu Temple. So I sent him there. And then I dropped him off at Sungai Besi. Then I went back to my house in Subang Jaya. At that time, I already moved to Subang Jaya. So I used the, what do you call, Old Airport Road. So, as I drive along the road, I saw the cemetery. I'm so used to the road, you know, you take it for granted, it's always there, the cemetery. It has no effect on me. But that day, I pull my car aside. I drive my car aside, park there. Then again, I meditate on Maranānusati. Then you can see that some of the picture on the grave, the tombstone, are actually not old people. They are young people too. So I became very, even the desire to become, to practice even stronger, because we do not know when is the time, you see. Some die very young. And so I decided I will become a monk, very sure. So I told my mother I wanted to become a monk. And 1 year later, 89 December, I went up to Thailand to be ordained. Because I want to practice. So I wanted to practice.
So that's it. You're not the only son in the family?
No, I have two elder brothers. I'm the youngest, so that also makes a difference. Unless she practiced meditation and realized the truth herself. I have no, at that time I have no teacher, I do it on myself, I just follow what is, what is. Okay. You just remind yourself that death will take place anytime. There are many ways actually in the Visuddhimagga, it mentioned. Actually, I followed the white book, Buddhist Meditation. At that time, I have not read Visuddhimagga yet. So my teacher was actually that white book, Buddhist Meditation. All my, whatever meditation I do before reading Visuddhimagga, that is the book I follow. So what you should do is just contemplate, tell yourself, death will take place anytime. Death is inevitable, and they also quote many other examples to remind ourselves about it, about death. So for me, the most suitable is this, just this phrase, death will take place, or death is inevitable,
over and over again.
Just this phrase is just a word, so you must know the meaning. No vision, but you know that. No need to visualize, but just remind yourself, you know what death is stand for, you see? So you don't have to visualize yourself going through all that. That's from my own experience. Just remind yourself it can happen. Even at that moment while you are sitting, it may even happen, you see? Just remind yourself again and again and again and again. Then sometimes you can get calmness even from that. That's why in the book it just warned about this danger. Some people may get fear of death, so it's not suitable for everybody. Some may get fear of death. Some may say, oh, since I'll be dying tomorrow, they become, they feel careless about it. So this is the few danger about Maranusati. But the advantage of Maranusati is they put in more effort to their practice. They develop less attachment. And they die unconfused at the moment of dying. So these are a few advantages of Maranusati. One is contemplation and death. The other one is not related at all. One is kaya gata sati, knowing the body, contemplation on the body. Separate out the body so that the attachment to I is lesser. My hair, my nails, my skin, that attachment become lesser. The effect of these 32 parts, and also attraction to other become lesser. Has a different effect. I mean, you become less attached, so you practice. You do not attach to all these worldly things. The reason why you practice on that is to get less attached to all these worldly things, you see. That's why you practice Kayagada Sati. So it is conducive, also one of the advantages.
Sometimes things work when certain conditions present, and things doesn't work for some people when the same conditions are present. You like the Buddha story they talk about, as a prince he brought up in very luxurious surroundings, all that. And then they said that the four sides, after seeing the four sides, he renounced and seek the end of suffering. But apparently this is not the first time he sees the four sides. A lot of people would not agree that this was the first time he sees an old person or a sick person or what? Because it's not possible. Because his father is old, you see. Mm. There must be old people within the palace where he stays. There must be some people who are sick also. Mm. So obviously, yeah, but why doesn't at other times it doesn't click and make the mind do it? And
the fruit, the fruit is not, how should I, it's not bare yet, how should I say? Flower is not, has not bloomed yet. So it will not give rise to his renunciation. The conditions are not there yet, you see. When the condition is there, then
like just now Bhante mentioned about going through the I think the Bashra graveyard, many times I think I've taken that route.
Yeah, many times
it doesn't seem to click, but why at that particular moment?
Yeah. If the condition is not there yet. No. But where I stay in Thailand, each kuti is very far from another kuti. You have been there. So we cannot see another kuti. So you are practically alone by yourself in that kuti. So that is the practice in that monastery. To be as far as possible away from each other so that they will not come together and talk. So the Achan, the abbot, make it such that each kuti is very far from each other. So that's the kind of practice I have before, but not in a cemetery. For the Thai government and the Burmese government. In Thailand it's very easy. As long as you are ordained in Thailand, it's easy. But if you are ordained outside, maybe a bit difficult. If you are ordained in Thailand, you just get the provincial, district, and township abbot. There's a provincial abbot. Chief monk, there's a district chief monk, and there's something like a township chief monk. Three different signatures. You have to get signed on a piece of paper, on the form, and then after signing, submit it to the immigration. Then the immigration will do a police record check on the applicant, and that takes about 1 month. And then when after finished checking, the applicant will get a 12-month visa, so it's very easy. In Burma, it used to be difficult, but in Thailand now, I heard that maximum is only 10 years. After 10 years, the monk has to leave Thailand. But in Burma, it used to be very difficult. They give you only, for meditation monk, they give you only 3 months, sometimes 6 months, then you have to renew. And then after that, 2 years, you have to leave the country for meditation visa. But now, they are more relaxed. I can get, my latest visa is actually 1 year visa. And I can also get a re-entry visa. So now I have a re-entry visa. Plus a 1 year visa. And in Thailand it costs 500 baht. In Burma it costs 500 chak. That's about, let me see, 5 US. Yeah, that's black market rate. It's 5 US about. And it's for 12 months. But if it's a layman to go and meditate in Burma, he has to pay US dollar for the visa. I think it's 95. Do you know the visa fees? You don't know, huh? Yeah. I think it's 35 for 3 months, 6 months. 35 for 6 months. US dollars. And but now it's also easy, although they have to pay in US dollar. Both monk and layman is easy. Even tourists, used to be 2 weeks, now it's changed to 1 month tourist visa. So it's easy to enter Burma now. As well, visa is no problem for monks, both Thailand and Burma. Middle of May, most probably. Early May or middle of May.
What are the
requirements? Not at the moment, I haven't checked yet. I mean, I don't think it will be a very long list, because now Burma is opening up, so many medicine available. But I will let you know later on.
Yeah.
Like, I thought of getting prophylaxis for malaria. Malaria. Chloroquine. That's just an idea. I haven't decided. No. If I'm going to the forest monastery, it's only during the rains retreat that I will maybe taking it. Because during the rains retreat, there's more the probability. Yeah.
So prophylaxis.
Yeah, that's because if he has Vivax malaria, it stays in the liver.
Yeah.
It can erupt any time again. But falciparum it could stay in the liver too, but less likely than Vivax. This is prophylaxis is for preventive. Yeah, it's a different place. So it's supposed to be a malaria place. I'm not always inside the netting, you see. It's only during the rains that the probability is. But then, also I don't like to take medicine, so I may take 1 week, 2 weeks, and I stop taking.
It's better than getting malaria. Then
Dharma therapy. But it's just a thought, because as I say, I may not take it at all. But
so you say
yeah, I will take it for curing. Maybe prophylaxis, I may not take it for curing, in case any monk or any of the meditator get it, that anybody can take that medicine. Mefloquine, these two I'm thinking of getting.
Seems like the whole Burma seems to be teaching Marxist method.
That is the most popular, to agree. It has about 80 over branches. It's, I think, one of the most popular. There's Mogok Siaro. Mogok is also quite popular. Then there's Moin Siaro. Those in the books are Sunun Siaro. Sunun Siaro also quite. There's one French monk practicing there now. these few places practice pure vipassana, but samatha vipassana, only one place that I know that teach in the whole of Burma, only one place that I know that teaches samatha vipassana. So the meditator has to practice samatha first, and this the gateway to samatha, or rather the entrance to samatha, is to either anapanasati or dhatu kamatana. That's meditation on the element. For anapanasati, if he does that, he can attain four jhanas. If he do meditation on the elements, he can get up to upachara samadhi. That's excess concentration or neighborhood concentration. See, the then after that, after getting this, for anapanasati, after getting this jhanic concentration, then he can switch to vipassana. You know, to different, as in the same case, differentiate between nama and rupa, see the nama and the rupa in this body, and then after that, cause and effect, follow up to arising and passing away. So, also the teacher is very, he's not only the only one who teaches samatha meditation, but he's also very famous for keeping the vinaya, or strictly keeping the vinaya. He's very strict in his vinaya. The Buddhist monks rule. Also he, after that meditation, meditator is skillful. In this meditation, he teaches them the four, before he teaches them vipassana, that he has the option, the meditator has an option to practice the four protective meditation, like marananusati, udanusati, and metta bhavana, and asubha. So he also teaches them quite differently, because he teaches these four after they attain jhana. So his method is a little bit different. So he even teaches them abhinya. If they are, how should I say, after going through a course of vipassana, he can teach them abhinya too. The dhatu kamatana, he teaches is, instead of going from one object to another object, he usually, in the beginning, the meditator is supposed to be very clear on one element first, or rather one characteristic of the element first, before he go on to the second characteristic. Like just now I said, the earth element has the characteristic of hardness and softness. So in one sitting, the meditator will first of all look for hardness first, either in the sitting or the teeth. As he sit, he just sort of feel the teeth and know the characteristic of hardness. After this characteristic, this easy to find characteristic of hardness appear to him, then he look for this characteristic of hardness in his whole body. Then after, he go to softness, then he goes to roughness. Roughness, smoothness. Roughness, he can either, if he's wearing a very rough robe, first of all, he just feel the roughness, or any part that's rough, to get the characteristic of roughness clear to him. Then he'll contemplate the whole body, where there's roughness, he can find out for himself. Or even smoothness, sometimes if the robe is smooth, or the sometimes smoothness is, the meditator can actually lick the lips and feel that it's very smooth. Then from there, it's only for a few minutes, then from there he's supposed to look for this smoothness that exists in the body. Then after that, going to hotness, coldness, all the different characteristics, up to until he attain upajara samadhi, then he can do vipassana also. actually Upachara Samadhi also have the five angas of the first jhana, the five factors of the first jhana, vitaka vichara, sustained thought, initial thought, sustained thought, joy, happiness, and one-pointedness. It also exists in Upachara Samadhi, but they are not stable, very weak, if compared with the first jhana. But yet, enough for him to...